Brother. We're glad to see you all here this morning. It's a rainy day, and I know there are several who are out of town. I think the Ellisons and the Fortners, which Branson, I think is where they went. A few others are not with us, but look around and offer a little prayer to those who are not with us. We'll get back to us safely. I want us this morning to consider a statement made by God, one that relates to us as created beings, one that relates to Him as the great Creator, and it's a statement that He made during Creation Week. We are created beings, by the way. We are not the product of evolution. We're not the product of aliens leaving behind some bacterial refuse before they left this planet some thousands of years ago. Whatever other crazy, harebrained, cockamamie idea that is out there, we are made by God. Open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 1, and I want us to read verses 26 and 27. Genesis 1 is on page 4, probably, in your Bible, counting the index. Genesis 1, verses 26 and 27. My Bible reads it like this. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female, created he them. In particular, I want us to notice seven key words, one little phrase. They're at the beginning of chapter 1, verse 26. And God said, here it is, let us make man in our image. We're going to take that expression and break it into three parts. And from those three parts, with each one of them, I want us to make three observations. And at the end of it, we're going to take it out of order, but at the end of it, hopefully we will have an understanding of this text that is that will kickstart an idea in us to have greater extent of our Bible study. I want us to use this sermon as a deep, engrossing, as much as we can in the time we have permitted, Bible study kind of sermon, so that we can kind of scratch the itch that maybe you'll scratch on your own time when you're sitting at home on a Friday evening or a Thursday evening or whatever. If you just have a free amount of time, maybe you will pick up your Bible and not just read your Bible, but really study your Bible. From seven words, we can learn a lot, and we can just start to dig under the surface of God's holy book. I want to take it, as I said, out of order. The first thing I want to notice from that text, let us make man in our image, is the end of that phrase, in our image. What can we learn from those three words, in our image? First of all, the question should be asked, what is the image that we were made into? He says, in our image. So what is the image of God that we were made from? Throughout the Old Testament, for example, Jehovah, God, commanded and reminded his people that they were to abstain, that they were commanded to abstain from idolatry. From the beginning of the Israelite nation, God had been commanding his people that they should not make for themselves, my Bible says, any graven images or any carved objects. The meaning, of course, is that they should not worship idols. But what are idols in the traditional sense? They are sculptures of wood covered in gold or something along those lines. The idolater worships this carved image of a bull as though the bull were a god, or the god took the form of a bull. The object of creation, like nature, they worship these objects that God had made as themselves God. And therefore, idolatry is the highest form of disrespect that we can pay to God, when we worship something that He made instead of worshiping Him who made it. Do you not think one of the reasons why God never shows His face is because He doesn't want us carving that face into a block of wood, pouring gold on top of it, and worshiping that instead of worshiping Him? He doesn't want us making idols out of anything, much less Himself. Remember that on the foot of Mount Sinai, as Moses was receiving those commands, one of which was, don't make unto yourself graven images. At the bottom of the mountain, the people were coercing Aaron, and probably not coercing him too much, and to make another god for them, only because the reason they wanted that other god was because they were scared of God's voice. Imagine if they had saw God's face, how they would have reacted. So I think it's very telling that we don't ever see the face of God, yet we're told that we are made in the image of God. And then there's Jesus of Colossians 1:15. Paul says this, Jesus was the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. I don't have to see the face of God to see God, according to Paul. When I see Jesus, I see the image of the invisible God. Now someone says, but Jesus was a man. The word image, by the way, is icon in the Greek. Just like you have little icons on your computer, little pictures that represent what's going on inside the hardware. You have an icon of God, which is Jesus, this person that represents God. He himself is God. And of course we know he wasn't just God. Jesus was also a man, a God-man, yes, but still flesh and blood, unlike the Father and the Spirit, which are spiritual beings. But do you not think this verse ties in with what we're talking about? We are not to worship a golden calf, because that is not creator, that's creation. We are not to worship some man, because that is creation, not creator. But Jesus is the image of God, the man. Jesus is the image of God, the creator. When I worship him, I am worshiping God. I'm not worshiping creation. I'm worshiping the creator himself. I think the best way to understand these three words, in our image, is to first of all consider the image of God himself. What is God? Now that's a big question. So we're not going to try to answer that one exactly this morning. What I mean is, how do you understand, from our vantage point, our weak earthly minds, how do we understand who God is? I think the best way we can do so is by understanding that God is a three-part being. He is not three beings. He is one being. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, Deuteronomy 6:4. He is one God, but that one God has three personifications. He has three manifestations. He has three ways of presenting himself to humanity, to his creation. By the way, that statement that I just read, Deuteronomy 6:4, the Lord our God is one Lord. Who said that? Moses did. Moses, who was a messenger of God, who is a type of Christ, we've been noticing this morning, and who is inspired by the Holy Spirit. You see the three manifestations, the three ways you understand who God is. Father, Son, Spirit. Three independent yet combined personifications of the one God. There is one who speaks, there is the Word that is spoken, and there is the Spirit of the Word behind it. Is an apple an apple? Yes. Is an apple skin still an apple? Yes, apple skin is an apple. Is the apple flesh an apple? Is an apple core an apple? An apple is an apple is an apple. God is God is God. The Father is God, the Son is God, and the Holy Spirit is God. That illustration is not mine. It's from a children's book that we read our children. It's simple understanding of an apple, the three parts that make the one, but three individually are also the one. That's how you can understand God. Consider also, however, that man is also a three-part being. Now we consider that under the heading of in our image. God said, let us make man in our image. Well, God is a three-part being. What is the image of God into which we were made? And we were made into a three-part image. We are creatures. Creature, listen to the word, creation. We are created beings. We have a physical body. We are in possession of a mind from which separates us from trees and flowers and things that are technically alive but don't think like we think. We have a mind. That doesn't, however, separate us from dogs. You can tell a dog to sit and you can use its mind to know to sit. So we have a mind, but there's something else that makes us unique. We have souls. We're creatures. We're made. So are the trees. We have a mind. Well, so do dogs. But we have a soul. Now, we have something that eternally separates us from every other part of creation. When God made us, he made us different. I'll touch on that in just a little bit more later. But the very fact that we have a soul is that eternal link between this physical life that we have, this mind which began at our birth, and we'll continue on, but we have that eternal soul that links us to the Heavenly Father that an animal doesn't have, that a plant or a tree doesn't have, that thing that makes us special. My body is me. Take a good look at this beautiful face. You're going to see it in some form or another in eternity forever. You're always going to see this face. Now, it may look a little different, but you'll know this face because this face is my face. It's my body. You'll know this face because your mind will dwell in heaven, and if you're in heaven with me, you'll be in heaven because your soul has been saved by God. All three aspects of you define you. Your body is you. Your mind is you. Your soul is you. Is an apple an apple? Is an apple. You are you. You are a three-part being. So when God said, let us make man in our image, I think it's pretty clear the image of God from which he made us is this idea that like God has three parts, man also has three parts. Now, I want you to back up to the beginning of that statement. What does God say on the sixth day of creation? In order to make man, in putting that idea in his mind, he says, Let us make man in our image. Let's consider two little words there. Let us. Go back to the Genesis account. Your Bible open in Genesis 1, jump back to verse 3. I want to notice some other things that God said on that creation week. And tell me if you can't, well, don't tell me out loud, just think to yourself. If you can't think of something that sticks out as different from all of the other things that God said on the creation week compared to when he said, let's make man. Look at Genesis 1, verse 3. This is day 1. God said, let there be light. God made the radiance of the sun, the moon, and the stars. Day 2, Genesis 1, 6. God said, let there be a firmament. God put the firmament to divide the waters above from the waters below. Look at day 3, Genesis 1, 9. God said, let the waters be gathered and let dry land appear. God made the dry land come up for the waters and put the sky over our heads. In other words, let the waters be gathered, let the dry land be appearing. Look at day 3, Genesis 1, 11. God made the plants and the vegetation. He says, let the earth bring forth grass. Look at day 4, Genesis 1, 14. Let there be lights. He created the actual light of the sun in the sky and the light of the moon at the nighttime. He made the sun, moon, and stars continuing from which he made in day 1. Look at verse 20 of chapter 1. This is day 5. God made the birds and the fish. He said, let the waters bring forth fish and birds that fly. Look at day 6 of Genesis 1, 24. When he made the animals, let the earth bring forth creatures. You see a pattern here. What is the one thing that carries over with everyone? It's one word. It's let. Now that's the same as when he says, let us make man, but there's a difference. In all of the other accounts of creation, from day 1 to the beginning of day 6, as he's making the light, as he's making the animals and everything in between, he says, let there be, let this be, let this be, let this be, let this be, over and over, some form of those three words, let there be, until he comes to make man. He doesn't say, let there be man. He says, let us make man. There is something special about this creation. We are not the product of evolution. We are not just one more creature that was let there be into existence. We are a special creature that was made. Let us make in our image, which the animals do not have, which the plants do not have, which the planets do not have. We alone share and occupy that specific role of being made in the image of God. Let us make. There's something special. And it's not arrogant to say that. It is, in fact, a very humbling thing to think about. Notice Psalm 8, the psalm which is an ode to the creative power of God and to man's place in the creation. The whole psalm is a beautiful study, and I encourage you to do so on your own time. I want to just notice two verses of it, though. Look at Psalm 8, verses 3 and 4. David says, when I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you visited him? When I look up at the starry host, the beautiful of creation, the scene of creation, and I see all of that, I am inclined to say, David says, what is man that you would be mindful of man? What is the son of man, which is a phrase for creation, the people, humanity, that you would visit man, that you would speak to man, that you would desire a relationship with man? That's not a verse prophesying Jesus. We call him the son of man because he is man. He's the son of God because he is God. When David says, what is the son of man? He means, what am I? What are you? What are we? That God would have such a thought about us, that he would desire to know us and have a relationship with us. Observation, let us, gives us insight into this triune, this three-part nature of God. When he says, let us make man, us is not the angels with God. There's a lot of people, there is no Father, Son, Spirit, there's just God. And therefore, Jesus is not God, that he was just a man for a different purpose entirely. But Jesus is God, and he's part of that three-part let us. When you read let us, you know he's not talking about the angels, because let us is a partnership phrase. Let us is cooperative. Let us is working together. Let us is what God does with himself, not what God does with anyone else. The angels aren't our makers. That gives you an insight into the plural nature of God. Let us refutes the claim that Jesus is not the Son of God. He absolutely is. When you read John chapter 1, you read that amazing opening that describes Jesus as the creator of us all, that in him, through him, we were all made. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. And then you skip down later, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We know him as Jesus. In him was all things made. But then you go to Genesis 1, and you have this, let us. So therefore, Jesus belongs in that us. He's part of the Godhead. He's part of the Godhood of our creative power, of our creative beings, I should say. Let us gives us a picture into the harmony that God wants all believers to have. Do you remember my master's prayer in John 17? He says, I want all believers to be united as I am united with you. How united was Jesus with the Father? As united as let us. We're working together. We are one. That's how he wants all believers to be. He does not desire people who claim Christ to teach things different from one another, to believe things different from one another, to teach things different from one another, and to follow different ideas and different hierarchies and different religious bodies. He wants us to be united, and we can be united if we all follow the same teaching of the let us of God. So we have this who of creation, let us. We have the how of our creation in our image. One more thing to consider this morning, and that is the what of our creation. In our image, let us make man. Three implications to notice. One from the word make, one from the word man, and one from both of them. First of all, let us make. Make. Make implies, as I said at the beginning of the sermon, no evolution. There is a teaching out there. You may not know it by this name, but maybe you've heard it before, that basically says, it's called theistic evolution, that basically says God created through evolution. And so you can straddle both fences. You can have your cake and eat it too. You don't have to get made fun of for saying you believe that God made everything. You can say you believe in evolution and still claim you believe in God by saying that God used evolution to make everything. Well, you can be a soldier in the Civil War with a gray top and blue pants, but you're going to get shot from both ends. Nobody within their right mind should ever come to the conclusion from the Bible. I can't believe that line didn't get a chuckle at all. I can't believe that you should never come to the conclusion from your Bible. If you want to come to the conclusion from your own rationale, that's your business. But you should never use the Bible to teach that, because your Bible says just the opposite. Your Bible says that on the sixth day, a day, a 24-hour period. How do I know that? Because he had already made the lights in the sky that were already starting to revolve. They were already starting to turn on and turn off every 24 hours. That on the sixth day of those 24-hour periods, God made man. Adam lived to be 900-plus years old. The theistic evolutionary mindset teaching is that these days are eons and eons and eons of time, long, millions of year stretches, which is why they say you have these fossils that date back billions and billions and billions of years. Never mind the fact that there are rocks that exploded from Mount St. Helens, what was that, 1980? That are dated by the same measurements as 2.8 million years old. Well, it's not that long ago Mount St. Helens erupted. I think it was 1980 or so. It wasn't 2.8 million of years ago. There's something wrong with the metric they're using to measure it, but they have measured it and they've come to the conclusion this earth is very old. And so therefore, to justify the Bible in their minds, these people say these days were billions of years old. Well, Adam only lived 900 years. If these days were billions or millions of years old, how did he live, Adam, to day 7? Because he lived past day 6 to continue on in day 7 when somebody ate some fruit somewhere. So no, it was not millions and eons and billions of years of time. It was 6 days. Make man. Make. 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 Not let us evolve man. In fact, the word make is asal in the Hebrew. Let us bring into action. Let us cause to be. It's a sharp, instantaneous kind of word. It is not the word tzamach in the Hebrew, which means to grow, to fertilize, to evolve, to cause to come slowly into being. That's not the word Moses used. Moses used in Genesis 1, God said, let us spring into existence. Man. He wasn't starting a process that took eons of time to finish. He was stating an intention, and then he was doing it. Make. Make what, God? Let us make man. Man, as I said before, implies the distinctiveness of humanity. As great as the stars are, And as amazing it is to see them, or the moon or the sun. Remember the blood moon we had a few weeks ago? I took my big honking telescope out and stared at that. It was just the moon, but redder. But I don't know why, it was still fascinating. It's a beautiful thing. Well, you can look and you can admire the beauty of God's creation above your heads. But just remember that you were made special. You were made distinct from all other parts of creation. There is nothing like humans. And the people who hold to the idea of humanism, they should never even wear the title. They lessen the concept of humanity to just being a higher form of animal. We're not a greater animal. We're the only man. We're a special kind of being. If he wanted to make dolphins in his image, he would have done so. If he wanted to make monkeys in his image, he would have done so. But he made man in his own image, with a mind having free will, with a body to do as that mind desires, and with the soul that is on the line, depending on what you do with that body and mind. Last thing before we close, let's notice make man, because I think that's more than just make man as in humanity. Moses goes on to mention male and female created he them. Man implies man and woman, man and woman. I think make man implies the hierarchy, among other things, of the home as God intended it. Man was made, not woman first. Man was made to serve the Lord. Woman was made to help man to serve the Lord. Feminists can hate it, but them's the facts of the Bible. It is not good that man should be alone. I will make a help meet for him. Genesis 2:18. But people argue and say that's chauvinistic or that is sexist. No, everybody has a role to occupy and a role to perform. It's not saying you're going to be a servant or you're going to be a slave or that one is better than the other. It just means there are roles to be occupied in the home. So I don't have much patience for Christians who spout, let's just say, feminist nonsense, because it proceeds from the assumption that there is no God and that we're all just in this on our own. Well, if that's the case, then yes, the stronger woman could survive, the stronger man could survive. We're all in it on our own, but we're not in it on our own. We're all servants of God equally in our roles that we occupy. God is the supreme leader, and he made man, and then he made woman from the man. When you understand that fundamental, literally building block fact of humanity, it helps you understand why homosexuality is not authorized by God. He made woman for man, not man for man. It helps you understand why the leadership structure of the church is as it is. Why don't we have female elders or female deacons? Why do men take the leadership role? It helps you understand why marriage is the way it is, with man as the head of the house and man and woman together making children under them. In fact, that's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11:3. I would have you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of woman is the man, and the head of Christ is God. There is a hierarchy, like it or not, in place. Now, I said at the beginning of the sermon, and we're almost done. I said at the beginning of the sermon, I wanted this to be more than just a sermon. I wanted just to scratch an itch of prolonged, deeper Bible study. We had a whole sermon based on seven words. We didn't really jump around other verses. We didn't do a lot of other things. We just took 1/8 of one verse and found a sermon's worth of material from it. From your entire Bible, you could study this book at just that level, which is barely anything. And you could spend your entire life reading that book and studying that book and learning from this book. But people will put this book on their shelves and they will never see it, except occasionally they'll whip it out on Sunday morning, or they might bring it to a funeral, they might bring it to a wedding. But they'll never read it, they'll never study it, and they'll never see more than just what is on the bare surface of it, those 10 or 11 verses that everybody has memorized. If you dig into this book, you can find some amazing things. When I dig into this book, I can find from just seven words, I can learn about me and my place in creation. I can learn about God and his place as my creator. I can learn about me and my role that I have to occupy as a man, as a husband, and as a father. There's a lot that you can learn in just seven words. There are 7 million words. That's an exaggeration. In this book, imagine what we can find if we dig deeper into it. I said all that to say this. This year is almost over. Next year, I'll tell you what our theme is for next year. It is, what is the most that I can do? What's the most I can do? Not what's the least I can do, which is the phrase we like to say. What is the least I can do? Well, Christians' mindset should be, what's the most I can do? When it comes to my Bible study, what is the most I can do? I'm going to be preaching a lot deeper sermons. We're going to scratch under the surface of this deep book. And I hope that you'll be along for the ride and dig with me, not just on a Sunday morning, but read it on a Tuesday night, a Wednesday afternoon, and things like that. Until then, if you're not a Christian, You don't have to be a scholar of any kind. You don't have to dig deep in any way to know what your Bible says about salvation. It makes it as plain as day. You must believe Jesus Christ. You must believe that He is the Son of God, the Creator who made you, the same one who gave into you the breath of life, and that you took that life and you gave it to Satan. But because He died for you, He paid the price for you, He made it possible for you to be holy, which is our subject tonight. To be holy in His sight. You can be holy by repenting of your sins, by confessing your faith in Christ and being added to His kingdom through the water and grave of baptism. Put to death your old life, be risen to walk with Him anew. If we can help you become a Christian or be restored, let us know how, right now, as we stand and sing.